What's up, guys? So in this video, we're going to talk about what I call trickle-down inflation. So I've already made a video called How Inflation Actually Works. And you might say that this is a supplement to that. And it's highly relevant because it kind of explains how money creation affects the economy, not all at once, but more or less through what I call the money food chain. That's part of the same thing. This you could call the money food chain, and it's trickle down inflations. Let's just jump into it. Okay, so money's created by the banks. Banks do a process called fractional reserve banking. I made a video on that. You can watch that. You can look it up. Whatever. It's literally, in my opinion, like the biggest problem on planet Earth right now is money creation. Fractional reserve banking is just stupid. Really, the first problem is that we use bankers' money, but two, it's only a problem that we use their money. Well, it's not only a problem. It's stupid that we're using their money, first of all. So there's other options to use the money. That's pretty much like 90% of what the videos I make are about. But two, because we use their money, it affects us, and it affects us because they print it like crazy and basically inflate the supply. So they do this process called fractional reserve banking. I'm not going to get into that right now, but they create money. They create money and people borrow it. This guy over here, he wants to borrow blah, 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 so much money. It could be for anything. He could be buying a house, college tuition, a car, anything. Anything he can borrow money for and borrow money for. And when he borrows it, he goes in debt. He might have a negative 5 million negative money. I'll just put negative money, okay? But this guy, it goes right into his hands. He has positive money. And this guy, if this money, if he never gets that money, that sucks. But either way, this money comes in. This guy doesn't have to pay it back, but eventually he will give it to this guy. More positive money. Eventually, this guy, more positive money. Eventually, this guy's supposed to give this money and he's supposed to take it out and pay it back to the bank, but that doesn't always happen, okay? Either way, the point is, when this guy borrows it, he gives it to this guy, and it's debt-free. He has the money. And then he's going to take that money, and he's going to out-compete other people, since he just has so much money, for goods and services. I'm imagining, I don't know this, but I'm imagining this guy who's right here, first round, he's the receiver of money that comes fresh off the printing presses. I'm pretty sure he's a pretty wealthy guy. He probably is. He positioned himself pretty well in what I call this monetary food chain. So he will probably spend money on some type of luxury items. And then these guys, they're living a decent lifestyle. They own nice fancy restaurants. They might sell yachts and stuff. Okay, they're gonna take it. Same thing, they're gonna spend on something else. But eventually it comes down to the very bottom, the very bottom of the economy. And each round of this, they are competing with all of the regular old folks who just are, they're not getting money fresh off the printing presses. They're, trading with this guy or that guy. They're what I call old money. This is brand new money coming in. Old money, they're not getting money fresh off the printing presses. So naturally, there's a function of supply and demand that determines money's value. And it's really just how much stuff anybody, how much money there is and how much stuff people are willing to trade for. That's really what determines the value of money. I was gonna draw goods and services, but it's really just stuff. How much stuff people are willing to trade for any given money. So there's a supply of money, and as obviously when money's printed and comes in, it's going to increase that supply. But with that supply, there's a certain amount of people that use it that are competing for it. How are they competing for it? They're offering stuff, their goods and services for it. So per unit of money, you might say, there is a certain amount of stuff offered for it. If you increase, it's basically a ratio. You could just say like 1 to 1. If you increase the amount of money, you then got 2 to 1, per unit of money, that's now worth half as much. You can people be trading half as much stuff as they would before. Hopefully that all
you follow all that.
So yeah, that's really what it comes down to, how much stuff people want to trade for the money. As more money comes in, it's going to devalue the currency, like I said. But how's it going to happen? It's going to happen because this guy is going to outcompete, you know, old money. And eventually, the easy way to say it is he's bidding up prices. That's something I heard an economist, Peter Schiff, say. And I thought that's like the best way. That's a very good way to explain it. Bidding up prices, that's basically what inflation is. It's competition. And, you know, obviously people want to get as much money as they can for their stuff. So this guy is going to win the deal. This guy, whoever who has what this guy wants, he's going to raise the price. This guy has so much money, he's going to pay for it. And guess what? The old money, when this price is high, they're like, dang, I can't even afford that. So you got new money coming in, old money. New money's outcompeting old money. And yeah, it really sucks for all the... So really, if you're the higher you are in this economic monetary food chain, the better off you probably are in life. You know what I mean? Because you're getting money fresh off the printing presses. Even this guy who's borrowing money, he might be screwed if he can't get that money back. But if you're right off the fresh off the printing presses, dude, you're decent. So there's what I call the monetary food chain. Trickle-down inflation is just to describe how it all happens. You know, this is like they're both part of the same thing. Trickle-down inflation and the monetary food chain. You know, if you're up in the top, you're good. If you're old money at the bottom, and I'm not talking about like super far in the past, like you were inherited money. No, I'm talking like old money, like not fresh off the printing presses, like, you know, you're not up here in the monetary food chain, then you're going to be competing with these people, but these people are going to outcompete you. These people who are selling stuff, going to raise prices. You got to try to keep up with that. It's just not going to happen. And so all these people down here, the price of living goes up. They struggle. Those are the 9-to-5, you know, working man, grinding every day type people. And I would almost say that it's a system of modern slavery. It really is. And it's all because of this monetary food chain and trickle-down inflation. And yeah, it's eventually the entire, you know, money gets the whatever business. Let's say you work for a company, they'll be making enough money once this money comes down. Let's say all the way down here. Yeah, let's just draw another one. And they'll be making enough money that they can then maybe raise your paycheck. You'll be happy, but that's going to take a while. And in the meantime, before they raise your paycheck to adjust, you know, before they make enough money to really raise your paycheck, guess what's going to happen? You're going to be struggling. You're going to be trying to compete with these guys. You're going to be screwed. And that's just the inflation aspect. There's also deflation that comes into play, and that messes up a lot of stuff. And that's part of what I call the business cycle. I've talked about that. Yeah. So that's trickle-down inflation. And yeah, it's pretty much the cause of modern day slavery, you might say. It's so many people in the world are, you know, at the bottom, you know. Even if you're in the middle, you're still like just the middle, like dead center is probably what it should be in the world. You know, these guys are probably getting more than they deserve, maybe, because these dummies are just coming here borrowing money and spending on whatever. They might not always be dummies either. I don't know that, but either way, the top might be just abundant money and being able to spend it at this lower half's, you know, the cost of everything down there. And, you know, so they're gonna be living decently, right? But if you're below that line, you're gonna be slaving to the top half. And so yeah, it's trickle-down inflation, the monetary food chain, and what I would also call modern-day slavery. And just so we don't forget this, this is something to point out. Every time I draw this, I want to clarify this. The value of money is determined by how much stuff people want to trade for, right? And there's no such thing as a universal money. We don't even have to be talking about the dollar right now. We could be talking about greenbacks, any type of money that people want to use, right? And with that, there's a group of people that use it as money. There's no such thing as a universally accepted money. It's just not. There is a group of people that want to trade their stuff for money. And, you know, naturally, the bigger that group gets, supposing the supply stays about the same, you know, the value will increase the relative value of that money to stuff will increase. But really what I just want to point out is that, you know, this old adage that basically anything that people agree to trade their stuff for can be used as money. So we don't got to use bank money. We can use gold, we can use silver, we can use gold and silver, we can use other stuff, we can use government printed money instead of having banks print money, stuff like that. And just something to think about. I'm gonna leave it at that. And it's hot in here. Open a door, and then I'll talk to you guys on another video. I'm gonna cool down, chill, and yeah, I'm out of here. Talk to you guys later. Peace out.